Share my screen. So hopefully everyone can see that. Welcome everyone. So kia ora koutou, thanks for coming to our webinar for term four. I'm Nicole, I'm part of the online team, and we're just going to start with a welcome karakia. So feel free to join me. You know it. Whakataka taho ki te uru. All right, thank you, everyone. So, as I mentioned, welcome to our Term 4 webinar, and thanks for coming. So just a little bit of housekeeping, you'll have joined the webinar in listen-only mode, so the only options they have is to use the chat. Please do check if you're using the chat, check the drop-down. You'll have the option to either chat to panelists or all attendees. I suggest making sure that's on all attendees, so everyone, all the participants who joined us can see your chats. And if you do have questions about particular parts of the content, you put those into the Q&A box, then we can answer them all at the end. But don't put them in the chat, put them in the Q&A. And we'll answer them all at the end. And if you do have any tech support issues, if you get kicked out or anything, you can use the little hand-raising icon, and then I will check in on you. And if you need to leave, you can just click the leave meeting button. And if you accidentally get kicked out or anything like that, you can rejoin just using that link that we sent you. So today's webinar is a focus on digital resources and tools, and also celebrating the year that was. So we'll be hearing from Miriam, Anne, Lisa, Alicia, and Kathy from the capability team. And me, I'm helping out a little bit. I'm from the online services team. And as you will hopefully have noted, we are recording this webinar, and we will be sending it out to everyone probably sometime next week along with some notes. So that is all from me. I'm going to hand over to Miriam.
Great. Thank you, Nicole.
No worries.
Right. So hi, everybody. I'm Miriam. And first of all, I wanted to quickly say hello to everyone watching and listening to this final webinar for the year. And today I'm going to share a few tips about doing some digital tidying up of things in our online lives that might not be sparking joy at the moment. If there's anything that we touch on in the webinar today that you want to learn more about, then any of our panel or our facilitator team will be happy to help. You can always drop us an email or give your local facilitator a call, or you can phone 0800 LibLine to get in touch with us. And as Nicole said, remember you can pop any questions into the Q&A and we'll try and have a look at those at the end of the webinar. All right, let's get started. So first up, blog feeds. Reading blogs, I find, is such a great way to do informal PD about all sorts of things, school libraries, about what's new in books for kids, keeping up with what's new in ed tech, or really just upskilling on anything that you want to learn. When we send out the follow-up, we'll include a list of some awesome blogs to follow if you're getting started with this sort of professional reading. And we'd love to hear from you what blogs you're enjoying at the moment. So if you have a favourite, feel free to pop those into the chat now if you like, and we'll collect them up and share them with everyone in the follow-up. The only downside to subscribing to lots of blogs is that it can get away on you sometimes. I use Feedly app for my blog reading, and you're seeing what that looks like on the screen at the moment. And it does make it really easy for me to manage that when things get away on me. So all I have to do is go to the button that says mark as read, click, and they are gone, and that's a weight off my shoulders. And I know that there'll be new stuff coming in any minute. So Feedly also makes it easy to manage your blogs. You can organise the different sources that you subscribe to. It'll recommend new blogs for you to follow. And you can also see quickly what is not being updated anymore or blogs that have actually disappeared altogether, so that you can weed those out just like you would with your library collection. Okay, browser extensions next. So all the school library people I know are great at keeping an eye out for new resources and tools, sometimes to make our own work easier, but also to share with students and staff. And what's on the screen at the moment is a quick snapshot of some of the extensions that I use in Chrome browser. If you've got some favourite browser extensions and you want to pop those in the chat to share, that would be great. And we'll make sure that everyone can see the list of those in the follow-up. But what has happened is that over time, I have ended up with some extensions that I actually don't use anymore, or I don't use them very often. And the little buttons that come with the extension can crowd out your toolbar after a while. So in Chrome browser, when I click on the little puzzle icon in my toolbar, I get this screen, which can help me manage the extensions. So the wee blue slider pins and unpins those buttons from the toolbar. And for things that I'm just not using anymore, I can come in here and remove them altogether. So that's browsers. Right, the next thing, we are whizzing along through this, bookmarks. Now, when I started working in school libraries a long time ago, I found that I was collecting so many links to online resources that I wanted to share with staff and students that I needed a better way of organising them than just clicking the little star favourites button in my browser. And for years now, I've been using Digo, and you can see some of the terrible, messy, duplicate and unhelpful tags that I've accumulated over many years in Digo. So at the moment, I am having a tidy up because it's that time of year. And at the same time, I'm trying this tool, which is new to me. It's called Raindrop. And it is a really cool bookmarking tool. And so far, I like it a lot. It works on, you know, a range of different systems, you know, Android and Apple or different devices. It comes with a browser extension, which is what you'd expect. I really like the visual look of it, and it's really easy and intuitive to use. So Nicole, can I just get you to pop up a quick poll for us? We've got just two quick questions, which I'll give you a minute to answer these questions, about how you save and share things. So the first question is about what you use when you do this for your own use. And the second question, you might have to scroll a tiny bit on that wee window, is about what you do for things that you want to share with others, so staff and students as well. So just tick as many options as you need to show us what you do. And if there's something that you do which is not showing in the poll, then you can just type into the chat what you do. And I'll be interested to see what people are recommending in there. So this is just a very quick whiz past that poll. Sorry, hopefully you've all had a chance to make some selections. But Nicole, if you can whip it away and then show us the summary really quickly. And wow, tons of people using the favourites in their browser. And just a few using something online like Digo or Evernote. And for sharing with other people, the library's online catalogue is right up there. That's interesting to see. Fantastic. Okay, so we will follow up on that in the follow-up notes. That's awesome, Nicole, if you can whip it away again. Cool. Now, the next thing is about personally identifiable info, which is actually a really big topic. Now, you might have noticed yesterday on the School Libs listserv that Jane from Heaton Intermediate shared a link to a school library journal story written by Bernard Beckett, which was called News For You. And it's very timely for this webinar because some of the things we're going to touch on are to do with that personal information. Now, if you're an Apple user, you can go to privacy.apple.com to have a look and see what personal information is stored in your Apple account, and you can download the information from there to check it out. if you're a Google user, maybe you have an Apple phone and you might be an Android phone and your school is a Google school, you might be on Google all over the place. There's a couple of places to look at to check what's out there about you. One of them is myaccount.google.com, and that will help you check out your password and security info. It'll help you do a password checkup. You can see which other websites you have allowed to sign in with your Google account, for instance. And the other place is what you're seeing on the screen at the moment, myactivity.google.com. And here you can see what Google is storing about where you've been online and actually in the real world if you're tracking your location. So you can go to this web page and you can look at what there is. You can actually delete it and tidy it up if you need to. Just on the subject of this personal info, this website, Have I Been Owned, is somewhere you can go to check whether your email address might have been involved in any security breaches. So you don't have to actually go to the website to do it. You can just put in your email address and it will check all the big known security breaches that have happened actually over years to see whether your email address was part of any breaches. So if you put in your address and it comes up with some results, then having a tidy up of your passwords, if you haven't already done it, probably should go on your tidying up list. Because it is a trap that a lot of people fall into using a single password for all their online accounts. And obviously it's not the safest way to go, because if you're breached in one place, then potentially you're at risk in a lot of places. So your browser preferences can help you manage your password security. And I've set my Google account to help me do that. So in Chrome, what I can do is click the little key in the address bar, and then it shows me what it's managing for my passwords here. This is me on Canva. So it's got my Gmail account login saved, and it's also got a really old one that I can't even access anymore. So obviously I need to do a little bit of a tidy up there. It can also suggest a strong, unique password to use, which is a great help, so you don't have to try and rack your brains to come up with something every time you sign up somewhere. So obviously, if you're like me and you've got old accounts hanging around, it's a good idea to delete those. Okay, now, the other part of the personal info, which is tracked about you and what you're doing online, is the kind of stuff that goes on in the background that you're not even aware of. So you'll have heard about filter bubbles and how algorithms affect what you see or don't see online, which is like Bernard's story. And those algorithms draw on all of this tracking data that's built up about your movements online and about millions of other internet users too. So there are a couple of good tools that can show you exactly what is going on in the background when you're, for instance, shopping online. And if you go to this website here, I've just popped in Easy Buy to see what happens on that website. And you can see it is a bit of an eye-opener about how much is going on in the background that's tracking my visit to the website. Actually, I'm not on that website, but that's what would happen when I go there. So the other thing to look at then, if you're worried about this sort of thing and you want to be able to manage it, there are extensions like this one, Privacy Badger, for your browser. I mean, it just runs in the background and it will track what is going on in the background. So you'd be used to seeing those notices popping up all the time when you're online saying, this website is wants to store cookies. And usually we just click, yep, I'm fine with that, and carry on about our business. But with something like the Privacy Badger extension, this is what it looks like when I visit Easy Buy, you can actually take back some control of that and see what is going on in the background. So it might be something you want to check out. And just briefly on the subject of privacy, New Zealand's Privacy Act has changed this year. And if you want to know more about what privacy is like in a school setting, you can sign up to do self-paced e-learning modules that the Privacy Commissioner have developed. And there's one specially for schools. So that is worth a look. Anyone can sign up to do it. All right. Now, in a minute, I'm going to hand over to Alicia. But before I do that, I just wanted to share my latest favorite internet trick, and that is Chrome tab groups. Now, often when I'm doing things online, I end up with like 30 or 50 or some ridiculous number of tabs open in my browser, and I can't even see the titles of them anymore. With Chrome's tab groups, I can now organize them much better. And once I've put them into groups, I can expand and collapse those, or I can shift a whole group all at once into a different window if I want to. And for me, it just actually feels like a little bit of tidying up magic, something really simple, but it can help to relieve that feeling of information overload. So if you're a person with way too many browser tabs open and you use Chrome, maybe check out their tab groups. And that is it from me. So I will now hand over to Alicia. Are you all set, Alicia?
Yep, I'm all ready. I'm just going to start sharing my PowerPoint.
Awesome.
Here we go. So just let me know if you can see that or if you can't, team. That would be lovely. All right, cool. So kia ora, everyone. I'm going to be talking about helping our struggling readers via text-to-speech and video content. Now, if you're not familiar with what the term text-to-speech means, I'm sure you'll learn all about it during this segment. I'm going to be unpacking it all. So I have a background working with low decile schools in the Lower Hutt region, and many of the students I've worked with have had learning disabilities and were slow readers, and so they just needed a little bit of extra support. I've also had extensive involvement in Any Questions, which is just super cool. It's National Library's homework help site. So Any Questions operators have access to over 300 websites on a range of topics, and they teach students digital literacy skills via live chat, and those skills that the students learn basically enable safer searching. So the websites I'll be showing you today were ones I used as an Any Question operator when I was working with students who wanted to keep up with their classmates but struggled to read text-heavy websites, and they will be suitable for a range of ages. So when we're talking about learning disabilities and print disabilities, I'm just going to define what that is. So National Library's Print Disability Service defines a print disability as a difficulty or inability to read printed material due to visual, perceptual, or physical disability. So that could be someone with dyslexia or something like that. Now, I'm just going to go over a little bit of research on why it's worth familiarizing yourself with text-to-speech technology. All right, so there is significant scientific evidence that text-to-speech and other read-along technology have a positive effect on reading comprehension for students with learning disabilities. So this is an exciting result from a group of researchers who analysed about 81 articles on this subject, and this was what they found out. So we'll include that reference and all the links I'm going over in the follow-up notes, and I came across this research during my postgrad diploma in library science while I was developing online tutorials for students with learning disabilities. This is super cool. Have you all heard of the podcast 99% Invisible? So worth listening to. So they also have articles online you can read. This is their article taken from the article The Universal Page, and it's on the history of print disabilities and reading resources. This quote reflects upon the weaknesses of early audiobooks, so I'm just going to read it for you. They weren't listening for sonic aesthetic pleasure. They wanted the information and the fancy productions move too slowly for how fast they wanted to read. Eventually, audiobooks evolved into what we have today, where voices are like fonts, they're standardized, legible, and most importantly, they convey information without getting in the way. I mention this because people sometimes view the robotic voices used in text-to-speech as a poor imitation of reading and therefore not worth utilizing. While it's true, intonation and accent choice are important for listenability, the fact is when a student is using this technology to improve their reading comprehension, they aren't necessarily looking for entertainment. Oftentimes they just want to learn. So now we're going to look at some of these text-to-speech websites. Now, you're all really clever cats, so I'm sure you've heard of all of these websites before, or some of them might be new, but you might not be aware of how great some of the audio features are, so that's why I'll be highlighting them. First off, I'm going to mention the National Library resources that we have that have text-to-speech technology embedded in them. So that's many of our GAL resources, such as LitFinder, National Geographic for Kids, so cool, and Britannica, of course. So as you can see in that right-hand image, when you press the listen function, that's that little button up there, the sentences get highlighted in yellow, and then they get read aloud so the student can follow along as it's being read. Cool. So I'm going to focus on this particular website because it's got amazing immersive reader technology. Has anyone heard of Wonderopolis? It's been around for quite a while, and it is a US website that was created by the National Center for Families Learning, and they're all about eradicating poverty through education solutions. So Wonderopolis is suitable for junior primary, probably through to intermediate age students, and it's excellent for kids who with print disabilities because of the immersive reader function that I talked about before, and it's got really cool video content. So it's got a range of questions on it, including this slightly hairy one, what makes something alive? And as you can see, there's a nice big listen button that the kid can click, and then that takes them to the immersive reader page, which looks like this. There we go. So on this page, you have the option of changing the text. You can change the background to a different color. There's an option for line focus. So that basically would hone in on that first line, what makes something alive. So the kid can really focus in on what is being read. It's also got lots of different voices that you can play around with that sound really nice. So I'm just going to talk about two other text-to-speech resources I would recommend. I have to mention the Print Disability Service e-collection because it is fantastic and it is free. So this is through National Library. All you need to do is register, and it's great for your students who've got dyslexia or other print disabilities. And another resource I've been really enjoying is Learning from the British Library. They have got videos and podcasts that come with transcripts so the students can listen and read along at the same time. And this would probably be suitable for senior primary and junior secondary students. And I found this amazing page on myths surrounding mermaids, which is just so cool and would probably be really good for inquiry learning. If you could pop in the chat any of your experiences with some of these text-to-speech websites, that would be so cool. And any other text-to-speech websites you would recommend, that would be great. We can include those in the follow-up notes. So now I'm going to move on to video content. So I'm just going to mention these two before we focus in on one particular website. So Digital NZ, I'm sure you're all quite familiar with it, but the reason I really love Digital NZ is that you're able to refine your results to video and audio material, and it is all, you know, it's a massive collection of digital New Zealand content in one accessible place. And then there's Ngā Tonga Sound and Vision, which is the New Zealand archive of film, television and sound. And it's an audiovisual treasure trove spanning the history of movie, radio and television. So it's well worth checking out. All right, this is my favorite. Has everyone heard of the website The Kid Should See This? So cool. It's a collection of 4,500 plus kid-friendly videos. It's free to use. And many of the videos on this website are probably ones that you already use with your students when they're researching. But the reason I like it is that it's all kind of compiled into the one place. So if you're working with a student who is overwhelmed by text-heavy websites and they don't want to trawl through a web page that has got lots of text and find the video, they could go to this website, just start searching for their topic, and then they would get a whole bunch of educational videos that they could put subtitles on for and then read along as they go. They upload 10 to 15 new videos every week, and it's suitable for a range of ages. I've actually used it as an operator on Any Questions when I was assisting NCEA students with their bio and physics research. So that was pretty cool. And the website founder and editor is Rio Nakaya. So she does educational videos for kids and curates kid-friendly digital content and works on interactive projects for museums. So that's her deal. Cool. So here's just a couple of examples of what you could find on there. So there's this ancient Egypt video that is from National Geographic. And then there's this burning question we all have, which is stronger, glue or tape, that is from TED Education. And yeah, that's one of the cool things you can watch on that site. So I'm just going to recommend two more video content resources worth checking out. So the first one is Māori Television's educational offshoot Motetea, which is where you can go online, watch all these videos on demand about the meanings and origins of waiata. So that's just awesome. Also Digital Pacific, as they're all about celebrating the rich and diverse cultures of the Pacific via a collation of thousands of items held by museums, libraries and galleries around the world. So this is a slightly new website, and I think it's a pilot, so it's going until 2022, hopefully longer. And it's so cool because, as you can see at the bottom of that image, you can explore by media type. So if you click on that, you can refine your results to just audio and video content. So perfect for these kids. And I'm just going to finish off with another recommendation, Natural Reader. It's a website where you can drag and drop your text into that box right there, and you can have it read aloud to you, or you can upload a document and then convert it into an MP3, walk around with your document and read along a bit like you've got a podcast going on. And you can change the voice of the person reading, which I highly recommend doing, because anything is better than the default, which is US Sharon. There's lots of other options. Sharon is not the only option. So yeah, I highly recommend checking out a site like that. So we're going to send through all of these links in the follow-up notes. And please pop in your chat any of your recommendations for video content and text-to-speech websites. Lovely. I'm going to stop sharing and then hand it over to Kathy. Cool.
Thanks, Alicia. That's great. Hi, everybody. It's lovely to be back with you again in a webinar. My name's Kathy Kennedy, and I'm one of the facilitators based in Christchurch. And today I'm just going to very quickly cover primary sources. And the reason we've included this in a digital focused webinar is because we now have access to primary sources in a way that we never have before. So I'm going to very briefly cover where to find them and then some ideas of how to use them. So first of all, what are primary sources? Very simply, they are original, first-hand, unedited records of an event. So they were created at the time of an event, usually by people directly involved in that event. And as you can see from your screen there, they come in a wide range of formats, everything from a speech to an interview to a diary, an image, of course, a poster, or a physical artifact, an actual object. And they're not necessarily old or vintage. They could be as recent as a social media post. Now, the flip side of primary sources, of course, is a secondary source. So a secondary source will be an explanation or an interpretation of an event, often distant in time. So someone who wasn't involved, but they're explaining the event. And just to confuse the issue even more, when you find secondary sources, they often draw on primary sources for that information, and you find the two sitting hand in hand together. So where do you find all these wonderful primary sources? So as Alicia's already mentioned, Digital NZ, and if you want New Zealand primary sources, this is your absolutely best go-to place. I'll just show you the quick little search that I did. Here we go. Digital New Zealand actually has providers from all over the country. So it includes libraries, universities, museums, and often providers that you would never think to go to look for digital content, but Digital New Zealand will let you find it. So there's my search that I did for women's suffrage. And the great thing about Digital New Zealand is when you find the primary source that you do want to see, you'll get some more information about it, and especially information on how you can use it. So there's the copyright information for me, and I know if I can use that primary source and if I can reuse it, and it's great for students to understand that too. And of course, I can go to the original site where that primary source is sitting. So for New Zealand content, that's your go-to. Oh, that's going to repeat for some reason. Hang on a minute. There we are. The other great place you can go to is our website, of course. And if you go to our teaching and learning tab, you'll come to this page. Topic Explorer at the top there will be a great place for primary sources. Our New Zealand history topics will find primary sources for you. And if we go down right in the center of your page there, everything that I'm talking about today and more, you'll see in our primary sources tab. So if you want to know more, just go to that tab there. But that page there on our website is a great starting point. For international primary sources, here are four of my favourites. And of course, don't forget EPIC, that's sitting on that page that's got international primary sources for you. But these are the four that were my go-to and my favourites, especially Google Arts and Culture. You will link to just a wealth of museums and archives from all over the world. Another favourite there is the British Museum. So at the moment, that's actually closed, but you can take a virtual tour using Google Street View and walk the galleries of the British Museum, or look at objects up close in 3D. So just an incredible source of information through these digital content that we can get. if you've got other places that you go to find primary sources that you know of, please pop them in the chat and I'll make sure that they go into the follow-up notes to share with everybody. So how do we use these primary sources? Now, obviously, they are a source of information. So they open a window to historical events that we wouldn't normally have. They can challenge viewpoints about events. But the way that we really love to use them, and I personally like to use them, is inspiration. They can be an amazing catalyst for thinking and wonderings and questioning before you start an inquiry learning topic. So let's have a look at an example. Here we've got an artifact. Now, I haven't got the real artifact, but again, by the wonders of our digital technology, I can actually show students a picture of this artifact from the Canterbury Museum. And of course, we could start just thinking about, well, what is this? It looks like something you would wear because it's on a torso, but what's it made of? How old is it? What was it for? And all of those wonderings could be introducing something, a topic that you're going to take a little bit further. If you want some help introducing or unpacking a primary source, this little resource is brilliant from the USA National Archives. There's a set of sheets here for younger students and a set for intermediate students. And the sheet just takes students on a step-by-step walkthrough to observe and think about what they can actually see in front of them as that primary resource. And they've got sheets for photographs, documents, artifacts, sound recordings, cartoons and videos that you can see there. So this resource is actually in that primary sources page on our website, but we'll also put the link to this on in the follow-up notes for you. And if you're wondering what that artifact actually is, it's actually a life jacket. So it's a life jacket from the Charlotte Jane, which was one of the first four ships into Littleton Harbour, bringing European settlers, but I'm not sure it would keep much afloat. So yeah, interesting. So another way that we like to use primary sources, and you might like to give it a go with a group of students, is what we call the slow reveal. And it's using a set of photos or primary sources to initiate some discussion. So two simple questions: what do you know and what are you wondering? And you bring that to that photo. This is actually a video still. So the children will say, well, they don't know anything about that photo except they know it's a shoe, or maybe a shoe. They know it's a black and white photo, but other than that, they can't bring a lot of prior knowledge to it. But the wonderings are, well, whose shoe is it? How did it get there? And then you introduce another photo. Or in this case, I introduced an artifact. So again, what do you know? Well, we know it's a medal. We know it's probably old, but what are you wondering would be things like, what was the medal for? Who was it given to? There's some water damage, so how did it get water damaged? And one question that students might ask is, are these two photos or are these two sources related? Well, maybe. So then a third photo, who are these men? What are they doing? Why are they at that river? And then a fourth photo after some more wondering. And this time it's a poster, and you can see I've used four different primary sources here: a video still, an artifact, an image, and a poster. And then you might present them with the final image, and here is the thing that really goes aha, we're dealing with a bit of a disaster here. And this is actually the Tangiwai train disaster. And when you link this with the previous four photos, the wonderings again go to another level. So they can go back to the slipper or the shoe. Well, was it from someone on the train? Who was it? What was the medal for? Was it on the train or was it given to someone because of this disaster? And it's just a brilliant way to introduce an inquiry topic. The topic might not be about disasters or the Tangiwai disaster. It might be about heroes and heroism. So it can get those wonderings going. So just to finish up, as you can gather, we're all sharing some of our little favourite tools, and I thought I would share something to do with primary sources. And one of my favourites is definitely Papers Past. If you haven't had a delve into Papers Past, please do. It's newspapers from the 1900s, 1800s, early 1900s and 1800s of New Zealand. And I've done something as simple as asked children to pick their birth date from 100 years ago and explore the newspaper from that date. And they can find hilarious things in the classifieds. They can look at the advertising and just what was happening in New Zealand at the time. So well worth a visit. If you've got any questions about primary sources or you've got any other great sources that you know of, please put them in the chat. But I'm going to wind up and I'm going to hand over to Lisa.
Thanks very much, Kathy. That was really interesting. But first, we have some breaking news and you are the first people to hear it. The library is moving to Antarctica, and even at this moment, penguins are being trained to deliver books. Well, hopefully the wise amongst you can see that it says live, but it also says 1705. So you might be wondering why that is true. And happily, I can tell you that it isn't. So why is fake news so effective? Well, modern fake news is carefully designed so that its intended readers will not be able to detect that it's false. So unlike the joke about the library moving to Antarctica, it's much more difficult to tell if fake news is real or not. So it's deliberately designed to be attention grabbing, emotion generating, and believable. It's also deliberately aimed at targeted audiences. So we've heard from Miriam today about the way in which we're all tracked. Fake news purveyors track us as well. As human beings, we're designed and we're attracted to the novel and the interesting. And we're also pattern seekers, but sometimes we see patterns that just aren't really there. So why is fake news so dangerous? I mean, look at this particular website. I would love to believe that the human body isn't designed for exercise and that jet planes are soaring off the shelves as a numerical weight loss food. That would be just fantastic. Fortunately, I know that this is actually NetSafe's website where they've deliberately put together fake news items and they take you through the process for understanding how you can be tricked by fake news. But part of the reason that fake news is so dangerous is that it undermines our trust in the truth. It spreads more quickly than the truth. It undermines credibility and it breeds a kind of cynicism. So that in the end, no resource is trusted and we tend to give up and not bother trying. But we still have to believe and trust in some sources so that we can make important decisions. You might be interested to know that it's actually not a new problem. Part of the reason that we fall into these traps is the way we are as human beings. This quote was written by Francis Bacon in 1620, so that's 400 years ago. And we can see the same problems. We reject things because we're too busy to research. We don't want to make the effort. We don't want to go along with the science. We want to take the easy route and maybe go along with everybody else. But most importantly, and most basically, we tend to get our emotions and our reactions and let them get in the way of reason. So as librarians, we've tried over the years to come up with different systems to help our students and teachers assess different kinds of resources. Initially, these systems were designed to look at resources, just the specific resource, and try and determine their credibility. However, current thinking acknowledges that vertical thinking, where you just look at one particular resource, is no longer sufficient. Because the fake websites and hoax websites are so convincing, they can easily pass all of these tests. So now it's necessary to look laterally, look at other websites and other resources, assess the original resource and see if it's reliable. We're not trying to suggest that we shouldn't keep on with the great habits that these systems espouse, but we'd like to suggest and share a different set of pre-assessment habits which will hopefully stop the click of fake news and that instant sharing. So what we'd like to share with you is from Erin Gibson from the University of Southern Indiana. And she spoke at TEDx a few years ago and suggested this particular process. So the first thing is to trust that gut instinct and go, whoa, what am I looking at? Can this really be true? So once you've had your gut reaction and you you trust your instincts and think, maybe this is just a little odd. You stop and wait. You don't instantly share. You just pause before you take action. And then you think, what? Is it possible that this might not be true? This is where you start your critical thinking, that we've all had our training in some of those other systems already. If you'd like the perspective of someone a little bit younger, this is Hannah Logue, who spoke at TEDx Youth last year. And she took the audience through the CRAAP process and explained to them how, having gone through all of those aspects of CRAAP, she looked at a website and it still looked as if it was completely credible. So she came up with her own acronym, which she called FABLE, and we will share that with you afterwards. But the E of FABLE for her was to exert yourself. It was to exert that moment where you think, to exert your willpower so you don't click straight away, to exert your critical thinking skills and to exert your common sense. So I'd like to share some resources that you can use with some of your students. Some of these are books from our collection. If you're starting to work with junior students, it might be quite difficult to talk about fact and opinion. So we've got some really lovely basic books that take you through that process. Fact and opinion can be quite complicated when they start to mesh together, but you can start with some of the titles from our collection. And if you want to find them, you can just use the subject headings that are listed below. You can try fake news, media literacy, or put two keywords in fact and opinion. A couple of resources that you might like to use to have on your walls just to remind your students and prompt them. On the left, we've got Library Girls tips and spotting fake news. And on the right, we've got a poster from IFLA, the International Federation of Libraries, just giving some ideas about what you can think about before you do that first click. I'd also like to introduce you to Harmony Square, which is an online game that you can play. This was developed by the University of Cambridge as a kind of vaccination or inoculation against fake news. And this takes you through the process of being a very dodgy newspaper editor who's trying to use all the tips and tricks of fake news to sow disharmony and discord in Harmony Square. So they look at things such as emotion-generating headlines, things that make you feel really angry, and that type of thing. And if you experience that as a person who's purveying that, then you might be inoculated against it when you come across it out in the real world. So finally on this, I'd just like to finish off with this lovely slide from Blockhouse Bay Intermediate. The lovely Donna has put this up. And again, just a prompt to her students, before you post, think, is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? And is it kind? And just to finish off with my favourite thing of the moment, the University of Wyoming has put together this online set of vertebrates, so a collection of skulls and jaws and bits and pieces of skeletons. And if you click on the individual item, you can swivel it around in 3D and look underneath it and look around and on top. So not only is it fun, it's also got that slightly creepy ooey feeling to it as well. But thanks very much for being with me for fake news, and I will hand it back to Kathy.
Thanks, Lisa. That's great. Thanks, everyone. Okay, so we couldn't have a services to schools webinar if we didn't mention Reading for Pleasure in there somewhere. And so I'm going to talk about a little bit about book trailers, which is the perfect marriage of Reading for Pleasure and some digital content. If you're not familiar with book trailers, think of a simple, short, quick promo. Think of a movie trailer, but for books, obviously. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how to find the best ones, some ideas for how to use them, and some ideas to get you started on how to make them as well. Okay, so the best place to go looking for book trailers, I think, is YouTube. You can't go wrong starting there. So you can see there I've done a search for a particular title, which is Fault in Our Stars, and added book trailer into the search. But the trick here is when you get the long list of results, which you will get, is to look for a trailer that's been produced by a publisher. And at the bottom of the screen there, you can see I've spotted one straight away that's been posted by Penguin Teen. And if I look at that trailer, I'll know that I'll get good production values and a good quality book trailer that I can use in my library. So here's another example, looking for Dog Man. And again, in my search results, I've just spotted the one that's been posted by Scholastic. And it's also got official book trailer, which is always another clue that you're going to find one that's got high production values. Now, of course, now that you know that the publishers are in there posting book trailers, you can search for a publisher and browse their playlists of trailers. So here I've done a search for Harper Teen, and the second result here in my list are a playlist from Harper Teen and their book trailers. I can click on that playlist and now I can browse through and take a look and see what I want to watch or use. Here are some of the publishers that I've had some success with when I'm looking for book trailers in YouTube. There will be others, of course. So if you know of any others, please add them to the chat and we'll make sure they go into the follow-up notes. But a great place to start is that Children's Book Council link that you can see at the top in YouTube. They've actually curated a great list of YA and children's book trailers, and they've used the high quality publishers trailers all in one place. So if you do want to start browsing book trailers, I'd highly recommend that Children's Book Council we playlist there. Okay, so what do you do with all these great book trailers when you've actually found them? So here's just four ideas. Number one is you could play them on a big screen in your library or beside a display, so they're on a continuous loop. You can embed them into your library online presence, whether it's your library homepage or a blog or a website, whatever you like to use. QR codes work really well with a book trailer, which you can add to a book cover. And of course, you can make your own, or rather, you wouldn't be making your own. You're probably, your students will be making their own as a competition or class activity. And again, if you've got other ideas of how you use book trailers, please just add that to the chat for our whole list of resources there. Okay, so if you're going to play them on a continuous loop in your library, you will need first to create a playlist. And in order to create a playlist, you'll need to be logged in to YouTube. And you can see up there, there's me. I'm logged into my YouTube account. Now, top tip here is to create a specific library YouTube account that's separate to your personal account. And the reason I say that is because should your trailers stop playing and it goes to the home screen, the whole world won't see all the weird and wonderful and wacky videos that you've been watching, or the weird and wonderful wacky things that are suggested for you to watch next. So keep it all separate, keep a library account. So once you've found the trailer that you want, and in this case, I've landed at Insurgent, and that's the one I want to add to my playlist. If you look down the bottom of the screen there, you're just looking for the little list icon with the plus button. And when you click on that, this window will pop up and you just tick which list you want it to go into. And of course, if you haven't created a list, you go create playlist and name that playlist. Here's a list that I've created, and you can see there's my name. And just under my name there, there's two little icons. So the first one will allow this list to loop. So as soon as you click play on the first one, it will just work through the whole list and then loop right back. And the other one is to shuffle through the list. So those are quite little handy things to know about. Okay, what about embedding your book trailer into your library online presence? Now, the best advice I can give you here is to go and find a tutorial or some help desk instructions or some advice for the particular platform you're using, because they all differ just a little bit. And it will be out there. Even if you have to search YouTube for a tutorial, there'll be something that will tell you how to do it. But essentially, you will be looking for this little share button down the bottom of the screen here. And when you click on that, this window will pop up. And you might be directed in your help guide to look for this URL for the book trailer that you're dealing with. Or you might be asked to look for the embed code. And that sits there at that little button there. And of course, you can see the social media buttons there if you're adding it to your library social media. when you click on the embed button there, you're going to see the embed code highlighted there in blue. So if your instructions are telling you to find the embed code, that's exactly what you're looking for. You hope the end result will be something like this. Here's a screenshot of a blog and you can see the book trailers sitting there. If this was live, that trailer would be playing as soon as I opened up that blog, and you want to look for that setting. So as soon as the page is clicked, the trailer is playing. And the other thing to look for is to loop the trailer. So when the trailer finishes, ask it to repeat. So if the user is still on that page, it won't go to a different video on YouTube. It will just play the trailer again for you. So I mentioned QR codes. Very easy to add a URL to a QR code. All you need is a QR code reader, and they are free, usually on the internet. This is the one that I use, called QR Code Monkey. You simply paste the URL in, it creates the QR code, which you copy or print and add to the back of a book, front of a book, displays, shelf talkers, flyers, posters, wherever you want to put that QR code. And your students can just use their phone camera to scan that code, a link pops up, and then they can click and watch the book trailer associated with that book. The last one that I mentioned was making your own trailers. So your students making your own trailers. And there are so many skills that come into play here. So a simple activity when you say to a group of students, create a 30-second book trailer, involves this raft of skills, everything from research to collaboration, to critical thinking, creative thinking, storyboarding. They need to understand copyright. They will need to master a digital tool of some kind for video making, music, just so much. And of course, a little bit of book knowledge along the way in there somewhere. They will probably have some tools at their fingertips already on your school devices. If you're a PC school, you'll have access to Windows Movie Maker. Apple, of course, you might have iMovie. And don't go past your presentation tools like PowerPoint, Google Slides, and Keynote. With use of the animations and transitions, you can create a really successful little book trailer. If there's somewhere else that you like to use, or a tool that you particularly like to use or have used for making book trailers, put that in the chat and we'll add it to the notes. So if you want to know more about making book trailers, here are three sites that I would recommend you go and have a quick look at. They are very student focused and beginner focused. There's a lot of information out there on the internet aimed at authors making book trailers, and they get quite complicated and sophisticated in talking about video. But these three are, as I say, very beginner focused, and we'll put the links to those in the follow-up notes. But even if you do a bit of a search, just be aware that you might need to filter out the quite sophisticated ones. And I get to share another favourite, and this one's definitely to do with book trailers, and this is Animoto. So Animoto is a brilliant little tool. I've used this in my personal life, my classroom life, my library life, and I've used it very successfully to make book trailers with students. It's a very simple drag and drop into a template kind of a tool. And so a lot of the heavy lifting for students is done for them with the template. So it's particularly good for younger students because they get a feeling of success quite quickly. If you've got students who want to have a little bit more control, there is another version of Animoto called Animoto 3. And there is a little bit more creative control in that one. Animoto does have a free version, which is all good news, but even the first level of paid for version is quite reasonably priced. And I have had about 20 students all working within one Animoto account quite successfully creating book trailers, but they just need to all be aware not to touch each other's little piece of work. So if you have any questions about book trailers or anything that you want to add and share with others, please put the question in the Q&A or put the tips and tricks into the chat. We'd love to share those. And I'm now going to finish off and hand over back to Anne. Thanks, Anne.
Thank you very much, Kathy. You've given me lots of things that I can play with in the weekend and over summer to see which one suits me best. Now, because we're talking about all things digital today. We thought it was a great opportunity just to share with you a quick reminder of where you can find us on social media. First up, we've got our blogs, lots and lots of blogs at National Library, but there are two specific, I can't language today, sort of it's too late in the day, two services for schools. The Create Readers blog is all about reading, everything from the latest book themes posts through to advice on how to create a reading culture. And the Libraries and Learning blog is more focused on those learning resources, quite often topical to the curriculum, and you get the combined knowledge and experience of the Services to Schools team and the wider National Library team. Where Services to Schools are also on Twitter, and you've got our handle there for keeping up to date with all the relevant news from school libraries, plus our new hashtag this year, which is daily book recommendations, the best of national and international books, or just those interesting things that catch our eye on the, as they go on the shelves. Of course, the National Library itself has its own Facebook page, and that's got blog news and events from all the different library teams in the National Library, including Services to Schools. But we're also on Flickr, where you can get high resolution images that you can download and use for free. And the Alexander Turnbull has a lot of ephemera and rare items on their Tumblr account. Because I'm talking about social media, my share today for you is something I discovered earlier this year when I was writing a lot of content for some of the blogs, the Create Readers blog, and that is the Hemingway app. It certainly hasn't stopped me burbling on so much in person, but it has helped with my written work, and I'm sure my manager is quite happy with it, me using it on my reviews, because they are much easier to read. As I said, that was a once over lightly on where you can find us on social media, and all those links will be in the follow-up notes. And I am now going to hand back to Lisa, who is going to celebrate the end of the year and our last webinar.
Yeah, Lisa. Right, so thanks so much to everybody for sending in all your photographs. It's just been so lovely to see them. So we're just going to share them with you and celebrate the end of what's been a very strange year. So now we'll hand over to Miriam.
You're on mute, Miriam.
Right, awesome. Thank you for that. Thanks everyone who sent in photos. I'm just going to quickly check the Q&A, but I don't think we've got any open questions there. So I guess it's the end of the year. Probably nobody wants to hang around and be asking too many questions this late in the day. But if you've got anything that pops up for you later that you've seen in the webinar and you want to find out more about it, then do get in touch with us. We'd love to hear from you. And we will round up all of the information that you've shared in the chat. That's been great. And make sure we send it out to everybody. That will probably be next week. So keep an eye out for that. Awesome. And I'll hand back over to you, Nicole, to take us out. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today.
Thanks, Miriam. I think you basically said everything I was going to wrap up with. So yeah, and we've already mentioned our social media. So thank you again, everyone. And I hope you have a good afternoon. When I end the webinar, it will kick you all out. So farewell. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye.